Greetings, spiritual warriors and magical mages out there. Thank you for checking in with me again. Today is going to be kind of a fun and lighthearted message. This is Age of the Mage podcast episode 13. And what I wanted to do today was all of us just maybe explore what kind of magic we like to use. What is our pathway to the spirit, to the soul, and to that zone, that liminal space that produces such strong meaning in our lives? There are so many ways and so many paths, and even if we fall into a broad category and prefer one type of usage or skill over another, we still individualize it, don't we? We just have such unique and beautiful paths to the mystical. But some of us maybe are tuning into the podcast with a deep feeling in ourselves that we'd like to explore this more and maybe don't even have a lot of this introspection about these different pathways under our belt yet. Some are very advanced who are listening to this and are really, aligned with a certain magical tradition or a certain way to produce their magic in their lives. And that's great too. So we're just going to kind of review some options that are out there. And I'm sure you'll find yourself maybe somewhere in this mix. And if you want to leave a comment, please do and share what your path is. If it's not in here, we'd love to know about alternatives, because people that are going to be tuning into this podcast are on this same network as you are. They're resonating as very individualistic, very authentic, outliers, very genuine, and kind of dedicated to the importance of following some kind of path, some kind of method to accomplish their goals with manifestation, but also to live in that very special zone and in that frequency and in that vibration, that being in touch with magic or spirit and soul can bring us. So you all have that in common. So any sharing is welcome. I think that one of the first things that occurs to any of us if we hear the word magic is we tend to identify it with maybe the Celtic traditions, Druidic culture, this kind of, the witchcraft and the warlock and the wizard with the cauldrons and the wands and all these wonderful magical accoutrements. And this is a perfectly wonderful and valid and fulfilling path. One thing I want to say at the outset too, before I even go on, is please never feel pressured, even by a well-meaning friend or a partner, to follow their path because it rings true for them. Sometimes that's a good beginning, and you can learn a lot by joining up with someone you trust and learning everything you can about their methods and their way. But, there can come a day where you feel, I just don't resonate to this as strongly as he or she does. And man, I'd really like to explore that one over there because it is calling to me. So I just went through an example of this talking to a friend who found this many years ago. And we've been in touch off and on for years. And she went through this where her partner for a time, or her friend for a time, really wanted her to go down the same lines that he was following. And she did, and she learned so much. But then this call to some of the northern, the Viking and the northern gods has been calling her so strongly. And she finally had to say, she had to claim that for herself. She had to say, hey, I just have to do it. I have to follow myself. And I have cherished every moment that I've learned with you here, but I've got to move over here now, because that's where my soul belongs. So this is very unique and individual. And so we sometimes think magic conjures up things, like the Harry Potter world, where we can wave a wand and make something happen, or put something in a cauldron, get a brew going, and have that be our way of transmitting magic into the world. So this is pretty common, and it's delightful. I remember when I was kind of leaving the traditional realms of Christianity that I had been raised with, and I still value that background as well, and I still fall back on some of those beliefs. So, but I was kind of emerging into creating my own destiny, my own path. And I just came across these wonderful books about paganism and neo-paganism and where they began and the origins and the Celtic ways and traditions. And it was, I felt like I had just come home. And sometimes we can find, I was reading books by Silver Ravenwolf, among many others. I can highly recommend those. And I know there's so many wonderful new authors out there too that are doing wonders in these fields. But I was so closely, I was so drawn to the Fae, in the land of the Fae and the Fairy, and this overlay in that area. I had ancestry from that area too. So I think, you know, all this goes into the mix. And sometimes we don't even know why we're choosing a certain kind of magic, but it can be karma, it can be race, it can be culture, it can be ancestry. And it also can tie into your purpose and what you're going to end up doing with the magic. It can also be a stepping stone. So in my case, I think it was almost more of learning what the importance of ritual really meant in a very soft and gentle way. I wasn't comfortable with high magic and extravagant ceremonial magic at that time in my life. And now I find myself turning a little more to that. So we do go through cycles and things that appeal to us. And some of our practice is simply laying the groundwork for future practice to come. So there is this whole world of this kind of cultural folk magic that originates in different ways in each culture. We have voodoo, Santeria, we have, you know, the Celtic and the Druid, and we have the Northern and the Norse magic paradigms. Some people feel very strongly about the Greek, and then there's the Ariadne, I believe it's Ariadne. There's the Italian witchcraft and the Spanish. There's just so much of this that they overlap quite a bit. And they do share a lot with paganism in that they really, they're down to earth, they're grounded. I like them because one thing that can happen is our practice, our spiritual practice, can get a little, sometimes maybe too disconnected from the earth life that we're currently living. And we can even maybe go overboard and not just disregard, but start wishing ourselves right out of our physicality. And so we have to remember, like, I love this. I love all these earth traditions because they help bring you, that you become a bridge between the divine, the source, the invisible realms, the ethers. You become a bridge between those and your world you're standing in. And so they're very practical. And I just adore these different paths for that reason. And another path that's maybe similar but so unique is anything in the shaman path or the American Indian or the South American Indian traditions and the, trying to think of the word just escaped me, but those are slightly different. Again, they're earth-based and they can be very practical, but they have such a different flavor, don't they? And so many people are drawn to those traditions and the focus with the shaman on the healing and so much work done in the astral space. So much soul retrieval work and healing at very deep levels and very tied to the outdoors again and to nature, but in a slightly different way than many of the other traditions. So we have this, that whole group with some overlap and so many to choose from. And you might, you know, it'd be interesting to just give some thought, like, is that where you're most comfortable? Is that how you plan to continue as you increase your skills and your power and fulfill your destiny? Will you be on one of those paths? Now, another path that I mentioned that I'm kind of moving into a little, at least sticking my toe in, is the more ceremonial, the high magician. This does utilize the angel names and angelology and studying angels, demons, their background, the calls. There's more ritual because in some of the others, their rituals are very tight and very composed and very specific. The same thing with this. I think maybe this also has people who are drawn to the Kabbalah and Hebrew mysticism and these types of paths maybe feel very comfortable working with high magic and ceremonial magic. I have had a couple very powerful experiences w using this in the last year, and I'm not by any means an adept at this or even a regular practitioner, and I want to be, but I found myself wanting to go back and do some research and even try to open up to some transmissions about what are angels. And I wanted to clarify, if I could, what I'm really working with here. And I'm just investigating this path. So it's bringing some interesting things into my life. Now, is that a path that you have found yourself on? Are you drawn to high magic and to the ceremony and to the traditions that involve the angelic names and those calls and those sigils? That's another avenue. Now we come to some, like, there's some kind of cross between the high magic and the folk or cultural magic and some of the secret societies, the Rosicrucian that grew into the Orders of Rosicrucian, and also maybe the Golden Dawn and some of these mystery schools. I believe they're kind of a mixture. You have very specific and high magic elements, but you have this undertone in many of those schools that's very earthy and very gritty, and it does feel different than straight up high magic. It has a different feel again. And so this would be another avenue to investigate. And you may already be very comfortable inside of one of those pathways, one of those set of traditions or methods, using their methods. Now, aside from those, and maybe the Egyptian magic and all these that kind of have a overlap, even though they sit on a spectrum, there's another thing that's happening too. There's very spiritual people who are just they just thrive when they feel as if they're feeding their souls, and they have these they have these moments where they know that you know that you are in touch with the mystical. And another whole avenue to this is the, I would say, the Far Eastern philosophies, Hinduism, Buddhism, the things that come out of mindfulness and Zen and these kind of traditions. They also can provide an access to these invisible worlds that can sustain you and fill up your life with the same kind of joy that any of these avenues can have to offer. And some people are very comfortable in those, and with meditation, a lot of use of meditation and chanting and the belief systems that are marvelous that grow out of those Eastern traditions. They have really contributed a lot to our Western cultures in the last 20, 30 years, because they did bring us this movement towards, we got to know the value of meditation in itself. That's marvelous. It helps our health and our mental acuity and clarifies the world for us and does so much that just the influx that we have gotten from even that aspect of the tradition has been amazing. So I find I have friends who definitely, this is their comfort zone. This is where they get the most pleasure and joy, and they go to chanting circles, and this just brings so much peace into their life, and that's where they feel that communion start to occur with the spirit, with their own soul. We have the maybe the traditional Christian path that people have come up inside, and they value the monotheistic God. They value these basic things they've been trained and taught, and they've had amazing results with prayer. They even approach angels a bit differently than the high ceremony. All right, it's a very different kind of approach, but they value angels as well. And yet, at the same time, I believe those who will listen to this podcast are reaching for some supplementation, perhaps, to that. to that background and to that method, you might find yourself in a sphere where you are very attached and comfortable and fulfilled in your Christian, your base there. But you also perhaps see some benefits in things that don't typically, are not typically taught inside of traditional Christian organizations. For instance, even meditation, or perhaps some form of divination appeals to you, the tarot or astrology. And these can be shunned in many fundamentalist Christian places. And so perhaps your soul is reaching out for something additional to come into your life, and but you still have a high regard for your prayer work and your basic belief system. This is wonderful too, because as long as it's serving you, and as if it's connecting you to the divine, which is your own soul, your own spirit, and that of the source and the creator and the God above, below, inside all of us. If that pathway is serving you and bringing you joy, and you thrive within that pathway, that's another perfectly valid and wonderful, rewarding way to find the meaning you're seeking for, the meaning we look for, right? And so I would love to have any of you in any tradition. Please, I would encourage you to allow yourself to follow your promptings, follow your intuition. If you have been involved in one tradition, whether it's Christianity or Islam or Hinduism or Wicca or shamanism, whatever your background is, if your heart is calling to you, saying, I'd like you to look over here, there's something here for you, and it doesn't fit necessarily into your background, I'd like you to approach that with some curiosity and kind of honor that intuition that's coming up for you and say, it might be okay to step over there and take some looks. That's okay. Because if you broaden your base, and those steps you take to do that are kind of nudged or prodded by your intuition, and you'll be fine. You'll be fine. And you will attract into your life a new component that might really serve you and might take your access to these invisible realms up to the next level. And so I would advise you not to fear going outside whatever boundaries you have actually set up for yourself. We all do it. We have our comfort zones. We have things that work. And I have found in my life, I'll spend some time in almost like this little circle, this bubble that I feel very good about. And I'm having a lot of synchronicity. I'm in the flow. Magic moments are happening. And then, you know, it might be that same little space for a few years. And all of a sudden, I'll look over there and I'll go, wow, you know, that's interesting. Why did I never look at that before? And that's my spirit telling me, you're ready to bite off that chunk and take a look. So I would encourage you, because this is what forms your own path. Taking these things, you become eclectic. You gather up what works for you, and you create a very detailed, specific, and original path for yourself. And this will give you the most power. It will also give you the most access to your joy, to your happiness, and to be in touch with your soul and all things spirit. So there's another one, and this would be the kind of person who really has not ever set up any kind of real methods. Like maybe you've never read a book on any of these things. It just hasn't been in your vocabulary or in your basic interests. Maybe you come by some of your gifts very naturally. You just have always been psychic. You maybe have always been able to make someone feel better. You maybe have some healing that runs through your body, and this has been apparent to you from childhood. Perhaps you see ghosts and other beings and other dimensions, and this has always been with you. And yet you've never followed like certain methods to necessarily increase your abilities to do these, to enhance these natural gifts you have. So for those of you who find yourself in that position, please just give yourself permission to explore ways, because there's just a myriad of things out there these days that you could tap into that might enhance your already natural strong powers. I also think some people who fall into the starseed category or galactic hybrids, and even abductees who sometimes later learn they are hybrids or learn that they have very strong ties that they can actually now remember with extra dimensional and extra terrestrial species and begin to get messages from them. Again, if that is you, you may never have, even looked at things like, well, did you ever care about getting a tarot reading? Did you ever cast runes? Did you ever consider the I Ching? Did you ever look at a witchcraft book? Maybe not, because your connections were coming so honestly and so in such a pure way to your personal connections there that you maybe never felt the need. And that's fine too, because if that need is not there, or your intuition isn't prodding you to look in certain directions, you're fine right where you are, because that's your intuition telling you, hey, we are good right where we are, and we're going to just keep doing what we're doing because it's working, and it'll get stronger, and it'll get more predictable and more reliable, and it will be something I can share, just staying put, just using what I already know how to do and doing more of it. So as you can see from this little talk, so many things are out there to explore. And I think that there can be fear. We can have fear when we go outside of our box, of our belief systems. It can produce fear at first. I went through it myself. Oh, believe me. I know what opening up and awakening can do firsthand in all ways, right? In magic and spirit, and also in truth and things that we're opening our eyes to in our world right now. It can be a very painful and scary process. But when you get on the other side, and when you've crossed that bridge, most often you look back and go, wow, that was worth the journey. Look at this side. This has things over here I never would have known about it had I not crossed that bridge. So I would encourage all of you to give this some thought and identify where have you been comfortable? What methods have you been using? What seems to work the best for you? Maybe you simply have dreams, and the dreams are partially prophetic, or they're very lucid, and you may sense that you're actually astral traveling, and this may be a very natural talent. What can you do with that? Because I think what we want to do, and we're going to work through this in our ne in several of our upcoming podcasts, is we're going back to know thyself, because as we move forward, we want to understand where we are and where we've been. This will give us knowledge as to and promptings, and open up the world for us to use and take part in, so that we can strengthen our skills and really begin to refine them and tune them. And this is going to help us in all our futures, both individually and collectively. So this has been a very kind of lighthearted, approach to introducing some of the various paths, some of the ways people use magic. We'll have several talks coming up about light and dark, and about white and gray and black magic and what those mean. But I will suggest for now that if you approach any investigation with genuine curiosity and you surround yourself in the highest vibrations you can, you should find that your exploration goes well. It goes well. And a lot of the times, the fears that we feel about reaching out and trying new things, yes, fear can be healthy because it can warn us. Uh-oh, we might be going towards something that's harmful. But in this case, in most of my experience, the fears have been put upon us culturally. They're stories we've been told. And whether intended or not, they do tend to keep people in line. When you have fear operating and you tell people bad things will happen if you go over there, a lot of people will say, well, and I'm not going over there. We aren't going to test the waters then, right? And I found that by gradually and carefully experimenting, exploring, testing waters, I opened up worlds to myself that I had no idea existed. And my life would just not be as full without them. And I wouldn't have nearly as much understanding of how varied and how interesting everyone else's approaches are, and how much there is to be gained from each one of your lives and your stories and your methods. It's just fabulous. It's such an exchange that I have found it to be worth it. And I wish you the very best. And this is just a message to have some fun with and think about over the next day or two, and see, hey, what do I like? What do I tend to resonate with? Because as we go forward, we'll want to use our strengths. And when we work inside areas that we know work for us, we reinforce and we exponentially increase what we can do. So we also have things like law of attraction, which is very gentle kind of magic. Truly, it is. And other things we haven't even mentioned. I know some people work with etheric magic quite a bit, thought forms, grids, geometry. The list just goes on and on. And it's fascinating. Thank you so much for being with me today. And I hope you enjoyed this little quick tour through some of the traditions of magic, and may you really enjoy the next day or two, and connect with whatever form you use to find meaning. Thank you again for being here, and I'll return soon. Bye for now.